So are you being able to see my slides now?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Sorry, I was a little bit late. I just finished another meeting. I was looking for the Zoom link and I wasn't able to find it. I was panicking. Where is the link for this? So thanks very much for the invitation, first of all. I met Maria last year. Last semester she was taking a class we do have in AGICOM, the AGICOM 528, which actually explores these trade-offs and linkages between among the human environmental health and the agricultural production trilemma. So my dissertation works around that on a global scale. And well, particularly this thing that I'm going to talk about today is the first chapter of my dissertation, which is related to food waste. So, I don't know. My name is Emiliano Lopez. I don't know if I was introduced before, but I can introduce myself. And my name is Emiliano Lopez, and I work in the AGICOM department here at Purdue. I hope you enjoy the food waste things. I've been working on this for a while now, and this thing was published in March, so it's a really new thing and ongoing. We are looking for doing different chapters after this. So any feedback or comment is going to be more than welcome. So the paper that I'm talking about is called the Global Food Waste across the income spectrum, and what is the implication that that could have for food prices, production, and resource use. So we, in general, in this group of people that I work with and in this class that I help TA in the AGICOM department, I work with Dr. Hertel. He's my advisor. And we have a group called GLASS. It's kind of global to local applications to explore sustainable development, and we frame most of these research in that group in the grand challenge that we have as humanity. We have decided these 17 global sustainable goals, and then as you can see, indeed most of those are in some way related to the production and consumption of food. That is because every time that we decide what to buy and what to eat, that those decisions, those choices that we make, have, in one hand, they have environmental implications because we use tons of natural resources that are also scarce to produce the food that we eat. And on the other hand, the food that we intake has a lot of health implications. So that's why the food system, the global food system, is in some way or in one way or another related to these global sustainable goals. As you could see in my slide here, there was this average fellow that we have in between this decision is gaining some pounds. So I started being interested in these topics because I was also interested in the long run evolution of BMI. And we can see, like, it's observing like overweight and obesity is increasing virtually in every country. So then when I start working on that, at some point, because of the methodology that I was using to trace the BMI through time, we realized, I will explain this later a little bit, but we realized that these two things, the changes in overweight and obesity, in some way, in many ways, were going hand by hand with the with the food waste. Those two things combined, excessive acquisition of food, part of that is intake, part of that is waste, and that has a lot of environmental and health implications. So then we had to split these two things, this analysis in two steps. So the first step was actually exploring the wasted part, the uneaten part of the food, and how that it was evolving through, across countries and across time. And then, well, my next step is going to be explore what is going on with the BMI. That's something that I'm working on already. So then going back to the food waste issues, the part that I'm going to focus today, well, that is a huge thing. It's so big that it's having like increasing attention from everywhere, like from governments, like international institutions, FAO, World Bank, IBD, research, academia. They have been an increasing amount of numbers of publications on these topics. And that's like, it's something that we are like exploring more and more, and we have been able to increase the knowledge through time, but in fact, there are so many things that we don't really know about the food waste and food losses all around. But we know that it's important. We know that it's on top of everything else, we know that it's sizable, it's huge, almost one third of the food that is produced for being eaten for humans end up uneaten. We know that it has a lot of environmental and economic costs. So we use a huge number of land and water, and we pollute the water and the earth to produce food that ends up trashed. That doesn't make much sense. But on top of everything else, on top of that, this is a huge social dilemma, because we do have a large portion of the global population. Of course, this is not uniformly distributed across countries. There are countries that where people is facing more food insecurity than in others. But at a global level, we know that at least 90 million of people are suffering hunger. And that number has been increasing, and it's put under extra challenges lately with all these COVID disruptions in the food supply chain. So we have in one hand a lot of people suffering hunger, and in the other hand, we have lot of food that is being wasted. So that's on top of everything else. So that's why this topic has been having increasing attention from academia, governments, and policymakers. So from there are some things that we know, and there are some things that still need to be explored. So for at least we know some things, like we know that food waste is huge, that's a thing, but that thing was largely being explored in developed countries or in industrialized countries. We also know that we need to work better in a standard definition for food waste. So that's a thing that confuses. Sometimes food waste and food losses are put together, and it's difficult to identify a limit when we read some published research. It's difficult to identify what is the limit, what is he referring to here. It's loss, it's waste, it's everything together. So we really need to work better in having a standard definition for that. And that thing also leads to, it's a really difficult thing to be measured. It's not an easy task to go house by house, household by household, counting carrot by carrot, how many of those were trashed, how many of those were over purchased for the household and ended up uneaten. So it's that thing also, it brings an extra challenge. So we actually don't have like great metrics especially when we think about global comparisons across countries, it's really difficult to do that task because there are not comparable data from one country to another. So those are big areas where people is working hard, bringing more standard definitions, working hard in the measurement of this phenomena as well. In my particular case, for this particular paper, I adopted one particular definition, which I think is one of the most accepted at this point. So we, in this case, we put the barrier, the limit between what is waste and what is household, depending on the stages in the supply chain. We know that we call everything that happens from the farm till the consumer's level in all these stages in between, like the handling, storaging, and distribution of food, all those stages, we call everything that get lost at those points, every inefficiency occurring, happening there, we call that food loss. And then whatever happens after that stage, when we go to the final stages in the supply chain, when we think about consumers, like consumers imply restaurants, households, and retailers. When we think about that, whatever happens in those stages, that's what we call food waste. And then, starting from that definition, my paper only focuses on the measurement and on the analysis of the food waste. So I'm going to be thinking on what is the food that is uneaten at the latest stages of the supply chain, whatever is going on in the consumers and retailers level. So the objective of this paper was to have an idea of how this food waste is gonna look like towards 2050. Then we wanna know how different factors will be affecting that evolution, like factors like the transitions in incomes and diets that are observed in different countries, how that is going to be affecting the food waste, the changes in total factor productivity, the population growth, the changes in the demand for biofuels that and other things that are competing for the use of natural resources, things that compete with food with the production of food for the use of land and the use of water to produce. And then on top of that, we wanted to introduce the complexities of future potential different patterns of international trade. Economists used to think in previous decades, we used to observe that the world was more and more connected and the trade was more and more, the international trade was more and more available through time. So we used to think we were going towards fully integrated the international market with every producer and every consumer would be able to sell and purchase at global prices and sell and purchase in the global markets. But now there was this huge political argument between big countries, particularly the retailers war between retaliation wars between the US and China that brought a domino effect. And we have seen lately a more disconnected type of world in terms of international trade with more barriers, more taxes, more subsidies, and so on. So it's so now we are not sure what is the likely future. So in that sense, we are kind of testing our results in this paper under different potential circumstances. Well, our original idea is that if we don't do anything, if we don't do something really meaningful, like successful interventions that are able to curb current behaviors, it's kind of expected that food waste is going to increase towards 2050. And then the other thing is any thing that we do to mitigate food waste, can save resources, but those things are always interacting with the international trade policies as well. I'm going to explain this later with the results, but that was another thing, that another layer of complexity that we explore. Okay, we have some room to improvement. We have some room. If we can reduce food waste, we are likely going to save resources. But then how that is interacting with international trade policies in the light of that previous thing that I was mentioning. So, key contributions that I will have here are that we actually came with a novel methodology. I'm not the first one doing this, but I think I'm the first one doing this in the long run. So we have a novel panel data set on an eating calories. Then we use that to underscore some underlying relationships between the long-term incomes and the food waste. And then from there, we can use that to incorporate in a global partial equilibrium model for the food system, food and agricultural system. And that helps us to explore some baseline scenarios, thinking towards 2050, what is the most likely scenario, and also some counterfactual scenarios of what if we can reduce food waste in this way, what could happen to the use of resources and so on. So that's kind of the leitmotif for the story. So exploring a picture of how the food waste and food losses looks right now. When we think about this in through the development spectrum, the picture is completely different when we look at an industrialized country versus an emerging country. When we think about an emerging country, it's easy to imagine that food waste, that food that is trashed at households, at consumers level, implies a small portion of the overall food produce. And that's because in those countries, in emerging countries, the poorer the country, the closer you are to buy the food you really need. So you are not over-purchasing food. But on the other hand, the food that is wasted at consumers level in developed countries, it's huge. It can reach 40, 50% of the food that arrives to those to that stage. So that's in one hand, that explains why most of the research in this arena has been done for food waste in developed countries. It's because in those countries, food waste is already big. It's already a big deal. So then when we think about what is going on in the other extreme in the supply chain, food losses, what we see is that food losses are huge in emerging countries, but those are really small in industrialized countries. And that is also something easy to imagine. It's because it's related with the available technologies for handling, storing the food, and so on. So but the other thing that is interesting is to observe, and some people have researched this, is observe how when we improve some things at earlier stages in the supply chain, how that change what happens in the later stages. There is a big debate now that if where is the intervention should be, should be working in at earlier stages of the supply chain, should be working at later stages, and then how all these things is transitioning as country gets more industrialized, food losses start decreasing, but then food waste at consumer level starts increasing. And that's kind of the idea that I capture in my paper. So, sorry. one second. So, I went back. I will go back to the previous idea, but then let me play the way we try to attempt bypassing this problem of how to measure the food waste. There is a thing called the FAO food balance sheets. It's kind of an accounting process. FAO reports all the food that is produced in a country by, like, I think it's 200 types of commodities, depending on the country. And then from there, in this accounting process, they add up and subtract different intermediate usages for the foods, including losses through all the stages in the supply chain. And then from there, the final value that they report is the food available at consumers' level. So, and accounting, and that is in quantities, in grams. I didn't mention, but of course, in these intermediate usages, they account for imports of food, for exports of food. Everything is kind of contemplated until this have this final number that tells us, well, this is the amount of food that is available. Dividing that by the number of people in each country, you have the amount of food per capita. But then another thing that they report is the average caloric availability. What they have is, well, we have all these quantities on grams, accounting for the edible parts on the food, they convert those grams in calories. So now we can add all those things together, because before we couldn't add apples with oranges, but now everything is in terms of calories. So now that we have calories, we can have an idea of how many calories are available per person per day in a particular country or region. And that is the final result coming from these food balance sheets. Our story starts from that final result. So their final result is the beginning of our story. The first thing that I did was to compare those average caloric availability with a thing that we call the average daily energy requirements. You know, there is this rule about the 2,000 calories per person per day. That's kind of the number in general that public in general tells. Well, actually, the number is close to that, but it depends. Each person needs a different amount of calories, and it's related to the body metrics: height, weight, age, gender, and of course the physical activity. So I built an average daily energy requirement per year, per country, and per gender, per sex, sorry, in another database, and then I could compare both of them. So the first thing was, well, while this average energy requirement is increasing through time, mostly due to the composition in the population, that means that a younger population on average will require higher levels of calories. Also due to the increasing body weight that we have been observing in recent decades. So someone that is more heavy will require more calories. So then accounting for those things, we can observe that the average daily energy requirements are increasing through time. But then in the other hand, the average availability of calories are increasing, and are increasing in a more rapid way. So there is already a huge gap between those two, and that gap is increasing through time. And I will show you after that that's a global level, what you're observing here, but I'll show you after that that's also true when we go deeper and analyze country by country. So another thing, another way to observe this long-term relationship is through these bubbles that are here. Like in the long term, we can see that average caloric availability are increasing. That makes BMI increase, but then also the increase in BMI observed, it's should be way higher if people would have been eating all those calories that are available. So, and that's true for most of the countries. So in the accounting process that I have done is we start from this average caloric supply, we subtract this average energy expenditure, as I explained, that we built. Then from there, we adjust by the changes in body weight that we observe. So that gives us an idea of the long term in the energy intake composition. And that gives us an idea of the amount of unneeded calories that are in each country. And we can explore that in the long run. So we did this here, you have an example of this process for the US, but we did this for many, many countries. By doing this, what we have as a result is that food waste is imputed as the difference between the availability and this energy intake. When we do those in many, many other countries, that gives us the possibility to explore the thing in the long run and through the income spectrum. So we split countries in different incomes by group. And as you can observe, and also as it was expected, more rich countries, they present larger amounts of unneeded calories with respect to the available calories. Then another thing is that we can observe is increasing in most of the countries, but for those really rich countries, it seems to reach a plateau or certain level. And this is kind of, it's mirroring a thing that we call the, can't remember the name, the Engels law in the food consumption. So when we think about the increasing in the income, and the relation with that of that with the increase in purchasing of food, there is a decreasing relation. Let's say we give an extra dollar to someone in an emerging country, in let's say in sub-Saharan Africa, they will spend larger of that extra dollar in the consumption of food. But if we give an extra dollar to someone in the US, they are likely going to spend a really small amount of that extra dollar in the purchasing of food. So then that's, as the income increases, food purchases increases, but at a decreasing rate, that's the idea. And then the reason behind that is because, well, at the beginning, we have to buy all the food we need to eat, but then we keep buying food for other reasons. We may eat different stuff. We may eat more than what we need, but then there is a moment we start buying food because we don't want to go too many times to the mall, to the grocery store, and then that brings the food waste at some point. So I'm trying to simplify the story here. There is a lot of literature exploring these linkages, like these trade-offs, and its opportunity costs of time and the relation with food waste. But that is the idea of why we find this kind of S shape in the behavior of the food waste at consumer level. So then we subtract, we use econometric models for subtracting the underlying relation between the unneeded calories and the food waste. And that gives us the chance of projecting towards 2050, what is the likely situation. Before going that, we also analyzed the evolution of food waste. As you can see, the size of the pies here shows that the food waste is increasing through time. And like the projected value for us would be almost the double that what we observed in 2013. Well, the relative contribution also is really important here. In early 90s, we have a really small share of this food waste coming from poor or middle income countries, particularly China, a really small contribution. But as the income in those countries keeps increasing, as those countries become more industrialized, food waste starts increasing. And given the huge population of some countries like China and India, well, we can only expect that if this trend keeps going, the share of food wasted in those countries is going to be huge. And those are going to be actually dominating the global food waste picture when we think of what is going to likely happen to the mid of the century. So going back to estimation, I say, well, we try different models. I don't want to bore you with this part, but we try different models like linear relations, non-linear relations, studied structural changes in the data. We did Gamper's approximations, but then we finally found that the logistic function was the one that was minimizing the square errors from the data observed till the predicted function. So we use that function to project to the future. So then to incorporate this in a partial equilibrium framework, what we do is, this is a standard procedure in global, in this partial equilibrium or general computable equilibrium models. We have some general parameters, and then we adjust those to make a particular point, a particular year, that everything is within the model and the reality are together in the same point. So then we can see how our model projects within a certain range before going for a long run projection. So I did that adjustment, that parametrization here, and it was working pretty well. Then I ended up incorporating that in a global partial equilibrium modeling. There are many options. The thing that I use is one that is kind of popular, really popular in the AGICON department, and it's kind of actually the head of, core of this AGICON 528 class that we do. It's called the simple model. The simple model actually has it's a simplification of the global food waste, where you have four commodities in one hand, where you have 15 regions that those things merge together to bring us certain levels of quantity and prices of equilibrium for those different commodities. We can go deeper on that if you have any questions in the model itself. But just in case we don't have people really familiar what we are doing here with this methodology, actually is having a really standard partial equilibrium modeling for the agricultural sector, which is a basic Econ 101 type of analysis. We start from an equilibrium point from demand and supply. Let's say here we are talking about a particular crop or livestock or whatever. So then we start from a particular point on time where everything is reality and the model, that's where we calibrated and our model to be. In the year that I used was 2006, which is the kind of standard we use in that data set. We are trying to update that, but that's the one we were using at that time. And then, well, for that particular moment, we have certain prices and certain quantities of equilibrium. But then we can think when we think towards 2050 in this case, there are things that are going to be modifying the demand. There's going to be changes in income, changes in population that change the demand for different items. And then in the other hand, that's going to likely bring us a different demand set. And then in the other hand, we have changes in total factor productivity. We have complexities arising from changes in productivity, labor productivity and yields coming from climate change. That's going to likely bring us a different curve for supply. And then we have those new things that are going to bring us different different sets of prices and quantities. And that's likely going to imply, because we are using resources in our production functions to produce these amounts, well, that's going to likely have implications on the use of resources as well. And then that's the baseline projection that we do. That's based on a thing that is called SSP2, which is an idea of middle of the road type of analysis, middle of the road in the sense that it's not a really extreme situation in terms of increases in TFP or climate change implications. It's a middle of the road, also analysis in terms of changes, future changes in incomes or expected changes in population. So it's kind of a really mild situation. That's why we use that one to contrast with some other possibilities. And that is when the counterfactuals or what if scenarios comes to play. We don't call this policy analysis per se, because we, in the analysis, we, that's a limitation of this type of methodology. In the analysis per se, we don't incorporate the costs of these policies or how we achieve these policies. It's just a what if scenario, in the sense is, okay, if we were able to reduce food waste in this case in certain amount, well, what is the likely implication of that for quantities and prices? So that's going to give us an idea. What is the likely implication for the use of natural resources? What is the likely implication for changes in food security? Because we are going to be altering the prices of the food. So that was the analysis I made. And then, well, after doing a historical validation to see that everything was going well with the model, we project for certain range of time and a standard situation for our models is that usually they project very well, they behave well at a global level. The deeper you go, the lower in the aggregation that you want to go, the less you can trust the results, the less accurate those are. I was in a good shape compared with other literature, so we could calibrate the model fairly well to make our projections. And then, well, we projected an eating calories towards 2050. As you can see, at global level, is likely almost doubling, almost getting to the double. It's increasing virtually in every region and country. There are some cases like Japan and Europe that you can observe that doesn't increase that much. Also, Canada and US is likely not going to increase that much. That is because those countries are already rich. They are already at the at higher level of high levels of and eating calories. So that means that it's unlikely that even we keep increasing the income in those countries, they are going to keep buying more and more food because they are already buying too much and wasting too much. But there are other countries, like middle income countries, particularly China is really interesting, where we do observe a huge expected increase in food waste. And then from there, we did these counterfactual scenarios. We split this in three different scenarios that we found would be interesting to observe. Share what if we could make that the share of food waste is only 20% in every region, so like make all the countries, which is in some countries will be an optimistic number. In a region like the US and Canada would be an optimistic number, because here we are already around 35% of food that is wasted. So it will need to reduce a lot to get that number. But in other regions, in other countries, they didn't even reach that number yet. So it's kind of possible, if we were able to curb the consumers' behavior, well, it's not that optimistic for those regions that we could achieve that number. And then the share of food waste 2020 means that what if we can freeze the share of food waste at the levels on 2020, and then share of food waste 2030 means that what if we can freeze everything at the level we will expect we are going to reach in 2030. So we leave everything increase, everything change free until 2030, and then from there we freeze and we keep going towards 2050. So we want to explore here because there is a huge debate on we need to reduce food waste to the half before we reach 2030 and so on. So we wanted to explore the time dimension here, how important is to reduce things the sooner the better, or that was the idea of comparing these 2020-2030 scenarios. And then we did all these three exercises under different conditions for the international trade. As I said at the beginning, we wanted to explore that complexity as well, to see how those two things interact. That's why you see two bars in each of these situations. And then we extracted results of, what are the likely implications of these scenarios on reducing the use of land? Of course, when we reduce the use of land, that also is also related to the use of water to produce food. And then that's also related to the greenhouse gas emissions. So if we are reducing land, that means that we are saving a lot of resources, and that has a cascade effect as well. And then we also wanted to see what is the likely effect of these policies, of these scenarios, not policies, again, these scenarios, with respect to the food security, focusing in Southern Africa, because there's where most of the food insecure people we expect is going to be when we think about the mid of the century. So, well, we provide evidence that there is a lot of room for improvement. If we can achieve any of these scenarios or being close to that in the reduction, in curbing future trajectories of food waste, that's going to save a lot of natural resources. And also that will have a lot of implications on food security in emerging countries. A really interesting thing here also, that was a big value added in our paper, given all the comments that we received, is that we show also that, well, reducing food waste in some developed countries is not gonna make that food is gonna magically show up in other regions. We really need to improve our policies in international trade and international connection to make sure that things that happens in some region really end up having spillovers through reducing food prices to other people in other sites. So there is a huge interaction between food waste policies and the trade policies as well. And that's true for the food security part of the analysis, but also true for the use of natural resources, because there are different challenges, particularly when we have a better integration of international markets. It ends up happening that the food the allocation of the food production, it's always more efficient than compared with a less integrated type of world. So that's why when you compare the blue bars with the orange bars here, the oranges are always higher. That means that, well, those food waste policies are always enhanced by these international policies. And then, well, finally, when you compare the 2020 versus the 2030, it brings like a huge difference. If we only wait 10 more years with these ongoing changes, it's likely that most of the increase in food waste is going to happen already. So the timing is also a critical thing in this type of interventions. So what can be done? As you see, I'm bringing on the table the importance of studying more what is going on in these emerging and developing countries in the food waste, because that's where most of the action is going to happen when we think about towards 2050. There are some successful stories. There are a lot of informational campaigns. There is one really big in the literature which made Love Food, Hate Waste, made by the UK, by RAP, the RAP institution in the UK. There are some other interventions, regulatory approach, like taxing food, avoiding the buy you get two, or changing certain types of advertising, the packaging. There are many interventions that have been successful, but most of those have been explored in developed countries. We still need to know, still need to understand better if those things are likely going to have similar effects or successful effects in complete different food environments. Something that we have done to curb consumers' behavior in UK may end up being not successful in a complete different environment as Niger or China or Mexico. Like, different environments means different potential outcomes. And of course, different needs from the consumers as well. And then another thing is that we didn't explore as much is the trade-offs, and particularly the opportunity costs of these interventions. We really need to explore more, especially in this other context. We don't know if, well, when resources are finite, we every time that we spend things, spend time and money and resources in doing some policy, we are neglecting that for other stuff that we need to do. So spending a lot of resources in reducing food waste in Niger maybe doesn't make sense, because you have some other problems like undernutrition going on. So those trade-offs and opportunity costs really need to be more explored, and especially in this other context. Summarizing here, the idea is that we found that the global patterns of food waste are evolving rapidly. Emerging economies are likely going to be dominating the picture of this towards 2050. Particularly China it seems going to be huge. The consequences of the any food waste or food loss intervention that we have are always going to be interacting or are likely going to be interacting with the international trade policies. International trade policies, like fully integrated markets, enhance the outcomes of the benefits of food waste or food loss reduction policy. And then we really need to work more in having better metrics, better understanding of the problematic for a different context. We really need to do that soon, because we are reaching unprecedented levels of stress in natural resources that's going on globally. And action needs to be kind of happening soon, because the more we wait, the less likely we are going to be able to curb the future trajectories of food waste when we think in the long run. Oh, thanks very much. I hope you didn't get too much bored. I will stop sharing my screen now, and I'm open to any questions. If you want to really know more about this, that's the name of our paper there. It's open access, so you can, okay. you can go and take a look on it at any time. I hope you enjoy it. Oh, thank you.
Okay, if anybody has a question for Emiliano, we can take it. If not, I know that we're getting close to that time where we usually let people go. So is there any questions? Okay. Well, Emiliano, thank you very much. That was very interesting, and it's something a little bit different than what we normally have. And so your paper is very interesting. So I do work in some of the, I do some economic work in my work. I work with Nathan Thompson and Carson Reeling from AgEcon. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for